time to die, or time to plan, or time to read, or time to kill, or time to heal, or time to have a time to read. To everything,
All right, so we started a new sermon series last Sunday, and we are talking about growing through the seasons of life. And to be honest, the message this morning has particular, I think, strikes a particular chord with me. And that's because we're going to be talking about the season of winter, the winter season of our life. And it's kind of it is kind of a cold thing when you wake up one day and you realize that that's the season you're in. It doesn't just happen, by the way, overnight. And so we're going to talk about the winter season. Now, I was thinking about that, and I was thinking, even through the series, how do we avoid people that would say, well, this isn't really where I'm at in my life. This isn't the season I'm in. How do we avoid you checking out on the message today? Well, here's the thing. We have to realize that every season that we're in is either connected to the one that went before, or it is preceding the one that's coming. And every season of life that we're in has something to do with the whole of what our life is. Now, not too long ago, during the summer, we were doing this series called Summer Road Trip. You remember that? And we talked about some of the places we are going in our lives. And one of the messages that I preached in that was that we need to begin with the end in mind. In other words, the question we ask was this: when you get to where you're going, where will you be? When you get to where you're going, you're on a road, you're on a path. When you get to where you're going, where will you be? Have you stopped to ask the question? This morning, we're going to ask, in some ways, ask the same question. You know, I was watching caught a video on Facebook the other morning. It's early in the morning, and it just, you know, it came up on my notifications, and so I looked at this video, and what really caught my attention was that it was a video of a baptism. And I'm always interested in baptisms, okay? And as I watched the video, I got to admit to you, I can tend to be an emotional wreck, you know, a person that puddles up and whatever. I know I'm a guy, we're not supposed to do that, but I do sometimes. And I was watching this video, and I got to admit, it was touching me, because as I watched this video, it was of a father baptizing his child. And the father was someone that I knew, had come to the church that we had pastored before. And in fact, he came to the church and he was lost. He didn't know Jesus. And his wife, who had grown up in our church, who he had married, she was very active, and she brought their children. But he was like, you ever, you know, somebody just at arm's length all the time, you know, just keeping everything spiritual. He was very, you know, cool, and he would come occasionally on a special occasion. And I thought, man, this guy, you know, it's going to be a tough nut to crack. Long story short, he got saved, and then he got radically saved. The guy that was like this became the guy that was like this, you know, just loving Jesus and loving the Lord, and I watched him start to grow. And I had an opportunity, because I was his pastor, I had an opportunity to input into his life, to coach and to disciple and to speak into his life. And I watched him grow in faith. And then, you know, what I'm saying is, I watched this video and I saw this man baptizing his child. And I've got to say, for me, that is the payoff. You understand what I'm saying? That is the payoff. Now, what does that have to do with what we're talking about this morning? Well, Ecclesiastes 3:1 is kind of our theme verse for this series, and it is this: there is a time for everything. There is a time for everything. Folks, we talked about it last week. That includes the good and the bad. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. So we're talking about those seasons of life. And to do this, to talk about the season of winter, the winter season, we're going to look at the life of a biblical character, a man that has had more to do probably with getting the word around the world than anybody else. That is the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul is writing a letter in 2 Timothy. He's writing a letter to his young protege, Timothy. And he writes to the young Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning in verse 6. And what I think we see in this passage, I think we see a man in the winter season of his life. And we want to ask the question today, what is this season all about? What is this season of our life? What is it all about? And when we look at the life of the Apostle Paul, I think we can see it. So let's look at it. 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning in verse 6. In fact, we're just going to read verse 6 first. It says, "For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time of my departure is near." We don't really know how old Paul was, but he was getting on up in years. But we do know this. We know from what he writes here that he is definitely in the winter season of his life. And remember last week we said that the winter season, and we can't define it exactly because we don't determine when the seasons change. We can have a loose idea. We know that the winter season of our lives probably begins somewhere in our mid-60s or so. It may begin a little earlier for some. It may begin later for others. But it's somewhere in those years of our lives. And we know that Paul was in this winter season of his life. And this is how we know. He says that, "I am already being poured out like a drink offering." For most of us, that has no significance. What does that even mean? A drink offering was a liquid wine offering that was poured over the sacrificial lamb before it was burned on the altar. In fact, it was the last act to be done before the lamb, the sacrificial lamb, was to be burned. And what Paul is saying here, Paul is saying that my life is being poured out as an offering over the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. In other words, he's saying that his entire life has been lived as a sacrifice. Isn't that what Paul had told us in other places? Our bodies are to be an offering, sacrifice to God. And so Paul's saying, my life is coming to this end. Now it's interesting, we're not going to look at this passage, but if you were to look over to Philippians chapter 2, verse 17, we find Paul making a similar statement. And this is in Philippians, it's in his first imprisonment in Rome. And in his first imprisonment in Rome, he writes to the church in Philippi, and he says these words, "If I am being poured out as a drink offering," if I am being poured out as a drink offering, he goes on to say, it's okay. If I'm being poured out as a drink offering. Now, there's a difference in these two statements. And by the way, this is the only place in the New Testament where these particular words are used, in Philippians and here in 2 Timothy, about being poured out as a drink offering. And the difference is this. In Philippians, he said, "If I am being poured out." And we know that he wasn't. We know that he was released from that imprisonment. He went on to serve the Lord. And he talks about coming to see the Philippians and all those things. But here in 2 Timothy, there's no if, is there? There's no if. He says, "I am already being poured out like a drink offering." What Paul is saying is, I know that my time is near. I know that I'm about to die. In fact, he goes on to say, "And the time of my departure is near." By the way, the word that's used there, the word in Greek that's translated departure, this is, again, the only place in the New Testament where that word is used. Significant, isn't it? He's saying the word departure, it's from a root that means to loose. It's the same word that would be used to release a ship from its bindings, its moorings, and set it loose. It's the same word that would be used by military soldiers to break camp, that they're going to break camp and move. And so Paul is saying that my life is already being poured out over the sacrificial offering of the Lamb of God over Jesus, and I'm about to be loosed from this life. I'm about to be released from this life to go on to be with the Lord. And so he is in the winter season of his life. And what I want you to see this morning is that the winter season is the season of peace. Now you ask, how can you say that? How can you take from what you just said that Paul is about to die for his faith? How can you say that this is the season of peace in his life? Well, we'll see when we go down a little bit further. But let me give you the winter forecast. Let me give you the winter forecast before we go any further. The winter forecast is this: to the unsuccessful person, winter brings remorse. But to the successful person, winter brings rest. Now, don't misunderstand the word rest. Okay? And also, let's not misunderstand the word successful or unsuccessful. When we talk about successful, we're not talking about the person that has made the most money, that has the biggest house or the finest car, or you know, has all of these things. We're not talking about success in those terms. Let me be real clear. I'm defining success in a very narrow sense. And we're going to see Paul define it as well in just a moment. But success for us as God's people is, have we accomplished God's purpose for our life? Have we reached the destination that he set out before us? Have we accomplished what it is that he wants us to do? And to the successful person who has done that, the season of winter brings rest. But to the unsuccessful person, the person who has failed to do that, it only brings remorse. Winter brings remorse. Now, let me just say, back up a moment now to what I said about, you know, our young people that are here this morning. And you know, most of you, our young people, are in the spring of your life. So what does the spring of your life have to do with the winter of your life? I've got my whole life before that time comes. Yes, you do. And it's going to go like that. It is going to go like that. And one day, you're going to wake up and you're going to realize that you're nearing the winter season of your life. And here's why that's so important. That's so important because what you do in the spring of your life, listen to me, what you do in the springtime and in the summer and in the fall of your life is going to determine whether or not you reach the winter of your life with remorse or with rest. And when we talk about rest, we're not talking about retirement, folks. I'm not talking about have you retired at 55, or have you know, are you not doing anything except playing golf and whatever it is. I'm not talking about retirement. I'm talking about rest. I'm talking about a spiritual peace. By the way, according, just a word about retirement. I have no opinion about whether somebody should or should not cease their work activities in the chosen career that they are in. I have no opinion about that, whether you should or you shouldn't. Here's what I do have an opinion about, though. I have an opinion that nobody that's a believer, that is a follower of Jesus Christ, nobody is called to retire from seeking and following after the work of God in their life. God is called. You know, see, Paul is a great example. In fact, go through the scriptures and you tell me you find one great person of God that accomplished great things in the kingdom of God, anybody that quit because they were reached a certain age. No, most of them served to the day they die. And that might be why I'm still standing up here this morning. And some of you are now thinking, oh my gosh, we're going to have this guy until he dies. I am not saying, even for those that are pastors and missionaries, I'm not saying there's not a time when, you know, even in the old, I'm not going to get in too far in that, but even in the Old Testament, the priests, they were told that there was a time when they would cease their temple activities. It didn't mean, though, that they ceased ministering and caring for people and nurturing others that are younger priests that were coming along. What I'm saying is, yes, there may be a time when I cease the rigorous activities as a pastor that God has committed. God has never called me to cease serving him. We do not retire from serving. That's not what rest is all about. So let's ask the question, then, what is this rest that we're talking about? Winter season should be a season of peace in three areas of your life. You're going to see it right here in this passage. Paul goes on to say in 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning in verse 7, he says, well, let me read all of it again. He says, for I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time of my departure, the time of being loosed, is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Also for you. This is true not only for him, it's true for you if you long for his appearing. If you have a relationship with Jesus, what Paul is writing here is for you. So the first area of peace that we see in the life of the Apostle Paul, even as he sits in prison waiting to be beheaded. He will be beheaded for the sake of Christ. But even sitting there in that prison cell, waiting for the time of his departure, he has peace with self. He has peace with himself. How much is that worth? I'm serious. How much is it worth to be at a place in your life and you can sit back and say, I have peace with myself? He says, I have fought the good fight. I have fought the good fight. In the expositor's commentary, I love the way it clarifies that when he talks about fighting a good fight, it can become confusing. What is he talking about? Well, he's really talking about an athletic contest. He's talking about continuing to compete. The expositor says, I have competed well in the athletic contest of life. I want to give you one word this morning. You might want to write this one down. First point is this. Paul had peace with self. And one word, the word is reflection. I do believe that the winter season is a season of reflection. There is a sense in which we are going to look at our lives and we're going to reflect on what our lives have been. We're going to look back and wonder, what has it been about? And the first thing I pray that we have peace with when we reflect on that is we have peace with who we are. By the way, that's the most important thing. Who are you? You know, I love the question, who will I be in this world? Who am I in this world? You know, being comes before doing, doesn't it? Because who we are is going to determine what we do. Are you at peace with who you are? You know, when I look back over my life, I started off with this reflection about this man baptizing his child. And the reason that is important is when I saw that video, it caused me to stop in this winter season of my life and reflect on what my life has been all about. And I'm not here, folks, please don't hear me say I've done everything right. I haven't. I've made some huge mistakes. I have. I've made some huge mistakes. But I also want to tell you that when I look back and I reflect over my life and who I am, I recognize that who I am has been determined by my relationship with Jesus Christ. He has shaped who I am. And I've watched him shape who my wife is. And I've watched him shape who my daughter is and who my son is. And now I've watched him shape my son-in-law and my grandchildren. And I've watched him shape people around me. God, Jesus, shapes who you are in this life. That's a choice we make. Are you at peace with who you are? And are you at peace with what you've done? You realize, see, what we're talking about here? This is the reason I think this is so important for our young people just to hear. I think it's so important for you to hear this because, you know, who you are and what you've done are all the result of decisions that you've made. And look, you know, if you reach 60 years old and suddenly decide, you know, I don't really like who I am. Well, it's never too late. Don't get me wrong. It's never too late to start. But wouldn't it have been a little better to start back when you were in high school or in junior high school or middle school? Wouldn't it have been better to start early to decide who you're going to be and what you're going to do with your life? And who is it that's going to guide and shape those issues in your life? Those are decisions that we all have to make in our own lives. Do you have peace with yourself? See, Paul said, you know, I have fought the good fight. I can stand at this winter season of my life and I can look back and I can say, yes, I've done it. Second thing we see is that Paul had not only peace with himself, but in a big, large sense, Paul had peace with others in his life. He had peace with others. I notice that next statement. He says, I have finished the race. And naturally, you might wonder, well, what does that have to do with others? I mean, it's your race, isn't it? Well, yes, it is. It's a race that you're running. It's a race that God has set before you. Hebrews tells us that we are running this race, and we're going to run it with perseverance, and we want to finish the course that's set before us. And yes, it is a personal race. But I want you to know, there are different kinds of races, aren't there? Anybody in here ever run a marathon? Any marathon runners? All right, way to go. Not many. Some. Any of you in here ever run track? How about track runners? Okay. Any sprinters? Any sprinters in the ground? Okay, good. Any cross country? All right. One cross country. My grandson runs cross country. In fact, last uh, last weekend, Don and I drove up to Waxahachie to watch him run. He's a senior this year, and so it's kind of like his final track meet. Cross country, and so we wanted to go see him run. But here's the thing. Some things really do. And Christian life is really, in some ways, we can find all of those races, can't we? Isn't there a time sometime when you would say that the Christian life is just, it's not a quick thing. It's a marathon. It's going to take time, and you just stay with it. But then there's sometimes, isn't it true that sometimes we just have to pour out all we have? We just have to sprint. We have to, like, I feel like sometimes in the season of life that I'm in, I feel like I'm trying to sprint for the finish line. I watched that cross country, and it was interesting because they all took off running, and we watched it as they started, and then we went down and we found this place where they came running by, and so they're you could tell they're all working their pace. But then we went to the finish line. We went to where they're finishing. And it's interesting because they've run this long distance, and yet at the finish line, they're sprinting for the finish line. Just giving it all they've got to reach the finish line. And I hear people saying, catch one more, just catch one more, you know, go, just don't quit. Sometimes I feel like, yeah, that's where I'm at in my life, in my ministry. Now, I don't want to quit. I feel like we need to sprint for the finish line. Finish well. But let me just tell you, I said all of that to say that the Christian life, I don't think is a sprint or a marathon. It's a relay. It's a relay race. Now, I have one of my other grandchildren, my granddaughter, who runs track. And I went to watch her last year run track, and she ran relay races. You ever watch the relay race? What do you have to do? Pass what? Pass the baton. You know what it occurred to me as I watched? When someone dropped the baton, they always lost. When somebody dropped the baton, they would not win the race. Because, see, in a relay race, it's not just how well you run your particular portion of the race, but it's how well you pass the baton to the next person. And if everybody runs well and everybody passes the baton well, then you win. Paul says, I have finished the race. Listen to what he writes to Timothy, also in 2 Timothy chapter 2, if you back up a little bit. Paul wrote this to Timothy. He said, and the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people, so be qualified to teach others. What is he saying? He's saying, Timothy, it's important that you also learn to pass the baton. You have to pass on what I have passed on to you. You need to do what? Pass on to someone else. Would you just turn to somebody right now and just tell them, pass it on. Tell them, just pass it on. Whatever you have, you need to pass it on to the next generation. Paul writes this to the Philippian church in Philippians 4:9. He says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. He said, you saw it in me, and I'm now passing it on to you. Put it into practice. I want you to notice something else. If you look down a little bit further, after Paul writes these words in 2 Timothy chapter 4, if you move down the page a little bit, Paul begins to say his final farewells to people. He's talking about his final farewells, and he's saying, it was amazing when I began to really look at it, how many names surfaced. Let me just read some of the names. He talks to Demas and Crescens and Titus and Luke and Mark and Tychicus and Alexander and Priscilla and Aquila and Onesiphorus and Erastus and Trophimus and Envulus. And Pudens and Linus and Claudia. All of these people are people in just a few verses, in just a few paragraphs that he identifies, people in his life. You see, what I'm saying is that Paul's ministry and his life wasn't just about him. It was about his relationship with others. And in fact, down in that passage in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 21, this is what Paul writes to the very person he's writing to, who is Timothy. He says, do your best to get here before winter. Do your best to get here before winter. Because Paul knew that if he didn't make it before winter, he'd probably never see Timothy again. And all I'm saying is simply this. That peace at the winter of our lives, it's not just about how we have run the race, but it's about how we have shared that race with others in our lives. And then number three, we see Paul had peace with himself. He had peace with others. And by the way, I was going to give you a word there, and it's up there now. The word is refocus. Wherever you are, see, wherever you are, in whatever season you find yourself in, it's never too late to refocus on the things that are the most important. And can I just tell you, listen, it's not, sure, we all want to make a living and we want to have nice, I mean, they're, all of those things are okay, but listen, none of those things will you take with you to heaven. Ultimately, it's the people that God has placed in your life that are the most important. Refocus on the things that are important. Number three, peace with God. Paul had peace with God. Verse 7, he says, I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. Two ideas around that idea of keeping the faith. One would be, and I think both of them are true, I think one would be kind of that he guarded the gospel. That is, that he maintained a solid doctrinal position. He preached the solid word of God. He kept the faith. He didn't stray from the truth. He kept solid. And we need to keep solid. We need to stay with the word of God. The other aspect of that is, accomplishing the calling. When he says, I kept the faith, it means that he not only has believed the right things, but he's lived those right things to the end. And if we're going to have peace in the winter season of our life, then it means that we need to hold on to the things that are important. Paul goes on to say, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. Crown of righteousness. Everybody that's a believer, everybody that walks with Jesus in this world, everybody that lives that successful Christian life, when we go to be with the Lord, I believe that we receive this crown of righteousness. And you know what? Listen, here's the thing. It's not your righteousness. The crown is not your righteousness. The crown is his righteousness, right? He is the one we've lived for. He is the one, listen, he is the one that died on the cross of Calvary. It was his righteousness that was poured out over us. We don't enter the kingdom of God based on anything that we have done. We enter the kingdom of God only based upon what he has done for us. It's his imputed righteousness that has been given to us. And so when we go into the glory, we enter the presence of God and we receive the crown of righteousness. You know, the scripture says that as believers, we are joint heirs with Christ. That means we receive his crown when we enter heaven. We are joint heirs with him, and what belongs to him now belongs to us. Joint heirs with Christ. Let me give you one last word. The word is reduction. The word is reduction. Have you noticed? Younger people won't get this yet, but older people will. You notice in the winter, all the leaves begin to turn yellow and brown, and they fall from the trees. And pretty soon, when you look at the trees, there's just these barren limbs stretching up toward heaven. There is a sense in which, as we get older, it is a season of reduction. And we can't do the things that we used to do. We can't do as much as we used to do. We can't even think as clearly as we used to think. That's not true of me, of course. But it's a season of reduction. And how many of you reach a season of winter and you begin to think about, you know, I don't need to be adding more. I need to be getting rid of some things. I need to reduce. And all I'm saying by that is for all of us, as it was for the Apostle Paul, the season of winter is a season of reducing things and asking the question, what is the most important? When all of it's stripped away, when it's all been said and done, what's the most important thing? When you get to where you're going, where will you be? Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy 6:7, after all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. It's a reduction. The only thing, listen, you know, the only thing that you can take with you is the people that you reach for Jesus. The people that you reach for Jesus are the only ones you can take with you. Luke writes in Luke 9:25, and what profit is there in gaining the whole world
when it means forfeiting oneself. So let me ask you something this morning. Regardless of what season you're in, maybe you're like me, and you know, I feel like I'm in that early stages of the season of winter. And I don't have time to get into this, but here's what I want you to just quickly say. You know, in every season of life, you can still have all four seasons happening within one season. You know, there's a time when God may be doing something brand new in your life, and he's going to take you through the preparation. He's going to take you through the perspiration. He's going to take you through the produce, and he's going to bring you to that winter season again, all wrapped up within that one season of life. But when you've reached this season, let me ask you something. When you get to where you're going, where will you be? Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you for your grace and your goodness in our lives. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to serve you. Lord, I ask that